I'd like to welcome everybody here this morning to Eastside Baptist Church, this glorious, wonderful Lord's Day morning. Everybody looks tired today. Wonder why that is. Well, this morning, as we join together to worship and we prepare for a new year, let us go to the Lord in a word of prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, God, we are just so thankful, Lord, for everything that you have bestowed on us. We are thankful for the year of 2019, all that you have accomplished, all that you have led us in, all the times that we have had the great privilege and great opportunity to come together and to worship you. And Lord, today we pray that you would guide and that you would lead this service, and it would be done unto your glory. For it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
I ask you to stand with us as we sing. We have one more Sunday to sing Christmas carols, so let's embrace those. We won't sing them again until next December. Let's stand. Hymn number 80, Away in a Manger. We'll sing the first, second, and last verse.
Thank you.
stand this morning while our choir comes down, greet each other this morning, and wish everybody a Merry Christmas if you didn't do that last Sunday. Seated.
As we come to prayer time, this will be the last Sunday that we meet other than tonight in this 2019. The year has gone by fast. The next time we'll be together will be next Sunday at 2020. It's going to be crazy. We have had opportunities in the past, this past year, to do things God has allowed us to do. And I just pray that in 2020, that we as a church, and I as myself, would take what God has given me and this church, what God has blessed us with, and go out and share. Do things for people. God has put us here for a reason. And I pray that everyone would take the challenge to do more in 2020 than we did in 2019. I think we always look and we see that are many people that were here last year are not with us this year. There's been some loss in our church. And we grieve that loss, but we excited about that loss because they are with our Heavenly Father. You know, that's the hope that we have as brothers and sisters in Christ, that those who have gone on before us that knew Him are no longer suffering. They're no longer going through issues, and that's something to be thankful for. And I pray, God, that we would realize that importance when we lose someone. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father, we thank you for the day, and we thank you for your blessings you've given us. And Lord, we just thank you for this past year and the way that you've led us and the way that you've done us. But Lord, that's behind us. Father, we have many things in front of us, many things we don't know about. But Heavenly Father, help us to be willing to go and to do those things if you want us to do. I pray for us as a church, Lord, that you just put your hand upon this church and God help us to be active, to be willing to do those things that are pleasing. Lord, we thank you, God, that we can go to a church that preaches the word and teaches the word and stands by the word, and for our pastor, the way that he preaches so much to us each and every week. Thank you, God, that he preaches thus saith the Lord and not what he thinks or the world thinks, but God, he's sturdy. And Lord, I lift up the ones that have lost loved ones. I pray, Heavenly Father, you touch their hearts. We know it's been a tough time, but Father, we also know that those that have gone on to be with you, and I thank you for that. And Father, we've got people in our church that are having financial difficulty. They might be going through some marital issues. They might be going through different things that we don't know about. I pray, Heavenly Father, you bless them. And Father, we thank you for the opportunity to have the Christmas store this year, and I pray, Lord, that you continue to bless us, the outreach there, and I pray for those families that came through, and I pray, God, that you bless them and encourage them. And Lord, we've got the program of Awana starting back up in a couple of weeks, and I pray for those kids that are going to be coming in. I pray for those families. I ask, God, that you just bless them, encourage them. Lord, those families going through some things that might not have been mentioned. They got some issues, and I pray, Heavenly Father, Lord, you just touch them, that you bless them, that you encourage them. And Father, I lift our town up to you. I pray for it, for liberty. I pray for our leaders. I pray for our state, Father, that you just bless our leaders. And Father, I pray for our nation. Father, we've seen so many things go absolutely crazy in our nation and our leaders. And I pray, Heavenly Father, Lord, that you speak to them, that you encourage them, Lord, that you just be with our president, surrounded by those Christian leaders and those Christian followers. I pray, Heavenly Father, Lord, that we lift our president up to you every day. Father, I pray for our military. I ask, God, you bless them. Thank you for the ones that have served in the past. God, that we could have the freedom that we have today. And Lord, there's those that are serving now to give us the continued freedom. And I pray, Heavenly Father, you be with them, bless their families. And Lord, as we come now to hear your word, I pray, Heavenly Father, for Josh. I pray, God, you bless him. God, you give him recall of the things that he has. I pray, Heavenly Father, Lord, that you just touch him in a special way. And Lord, I also want to lift our youth search committee. I pray, Heavenly Father, that you put a man in our way that's going to be here and, Lord, going to lead and guide and just bring a different part to our church that, Lord, we'd not. I pray, God, that you bless us. Continue to use this church in liberty. Continue to use our pastor and our people. And we thank you for what you do and what you're going to do. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Ask you to stand for our offertory hymn, hymn number 79, Come Thou Long Expected Jesus. We'll sing the first and second verse.
Come Thou Long Expected Jesus, born to set Thy people free from our fears. And sin release us, let us find our rest in thee. Israel's strength and consolation, hope of all the earth, thou art dear desire of every nation, joy of every longing heart. Born thy people to deliver, born a child and yet a king, born to reign in us forever, now thy gracious kingdom bring. By thine own eternal spirit, rule in all our hearts alone. By thine all sufficient merit, raise us us to thy glorious throne.
Dear Lord, we thank you for this day. We thank you for your many blessings. Lord, I thank you for the time that we have to come to spend together. Lord, I thank you for the rain. Pray that you just be with us, Lord. I thank you for this church. I thank you for what we have reached out to the community in this Christmas season, Lord. I pray that you just help us to be that church and continue to be in that church. And I pray that you be with Josh this morning. I pray that you will hide him behind the cross, Lord. If there's one lost soul, let him be saved. And be with these tithes and offerings that be used to your kingdom. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
We've seen a lot this year. Hatred and division. Acceptance and hope. We've met new people and said goodbye to others. We've seen war and violence and experienced love and peace. We've seen controversy and we've seen community. But the one constant, the one thread running through it all, has been Jesus. He has never left us, never forsaken us. He is the same today as he was yesterday. In our darkest moments, he was our light. In our deepest fears, he was our confidence. In our victories, he was our strength. In our failures, he was our grace. His love for us has never failed. As we begin a new year, let's make it our mission to be more like Jesus. To love more, care deeper, stand stronger, serve passionately, share constantly. May our faith be more than a title. May the very fabric of our being be consumed with Jesus. This is our calling. This is our mission. This is a new year.
gym this year, and I am going to lose 100 pounds. So I'm just going to eat completely clean, and I am going to be carb-free, and I am going to eat really healthy, and I'm going to get in that gym every day, and I'm going to run 10 miles or whatever, and I'm going to just exercise myself 100 pounds down. And 15 days or less into this, I quit because it's hard and I just don't have time to do it. I'm going to read my Bible all the way through this year. And then I got to Numbers and I quit if I got that far. The goal was really high and I wasn't really prepared to go quite that deep. And it got hard and time-consuming, so I quit. We come up with these New Year's resolutions. We say Happy New Year to one another, and we are focused on a happiness going into the new year. So this morning, God has challenged me to bring to you a different message. Not a Happy New Year, but I want to bring to you a message that I've entitled God's GPS for a Holy New Year. I want us to focus on holiness, not this idea of cultural happiness where everything has to go right in our lives and we have to be seeking this cultural happiness. So this morning, I want you to take your copy of God's Word and turn with me to Proverbs chapter 3. Now, most of us are familiar with verse 5 and verse 6. We could probably stand this morning and recite it or recite portions of it. But actually, if we're looking at context, which is king, and we're looking at the proper structure of the text, we really would have to read from verse 1 to verse 12. To really understand what is going on here and what the challenge is before us. So I want us to look at verse 1 through verse 12 as we think of God's GPS of a holy new year. But let me set the tone this morning. A couple of years ago, I was sitting in the parsonage to where the church I was serving, to which the church I was serving. And my phone rang, as it normally does. I answered it, and there was a man on the other end of the phone who said, "You don't know me," which is always a bad way to start a conversation. "But one of your members has given me your phone number and has said that you can solve my problem." In my mind, I'm saying, "Oh, thank you." And he begins to tell me that he is in a relationship with a married woman. And he says, "But it's not as bad as you might think because she doesn't love her husband. She loves me and I love her." And he begins to go down this road and he begins to say to me, his very obvious ethic, "Doesn't God, at the end of the journey, no matter what the situation, no matter what the sin, doesn't God just want me to be happy?" So after we go through and questions are asked, "What do you think the Bible says about this?" And he told me what he thought the Bible said about this, which was sin. But he went back to his ethic and he said, "But doesn't God want me to be happy?" And as the questions started coming in an over-the-phone kind of counseling situation, he referred back to his ethic. "Doesn't God want me to be happy?" You see the pattern here? No matter what goes on in our life, no matter what we're thinking, no matter what we're experiencing, the ultimate end is, doesn't God just want me to be happy? Regardless of what His Word says, regardless of what his character speaks of, regardless of truth, doesn't God want me to be happy? And the answer to that question to him, and the answer to that question to you, and the answer to that question to me is simply no, not in those terms. He wants you to be holy. And in the holiness of God, can you really ever be happy in a lasting way? That is why I believe the Apostle Paul was able to be content with a lot, and he was able to be content with very little. His contentment was not in a temporary happiness brought on by circumstances and brought on by the cultural realms of the day. They were brought on by his contentment in Christ. They were brought on by his holiness in God. So look with me at Proverbs 3 as we look at this GPS of holiness. My son, do not forget my law, but let your heart keep my commands. For length of days and long life and peace they will add to you. Let not mercy and truth forsake you. Bind them around your neck. Write them on the tablet of your heart, and so find favor and high esteem in the sight of God and man. Trust in the Lord with all your heart. Lean not on your own understanding. In all your ways acknowledge him, and he shall direct your path. Do not be wise in your own eyes. Fear the Lord and depart from evil. It will be health to your bone or to your flesh and strength to your bones. Honor the Lord with your possessions and with the first fruits of all your increase, so your barns will be filled with plenty and your vats will overflow with new wine. My son, do not despise the chastening of the Lord, nor detest his correction. For whom the Lord loves, he corrects, just as a father the son in whom he delights. Let us pray this morning. Dear Heavenly Father, it is a great privilege and a great honor for us to join together this morning in corporate worship, to give you honor, to give you praise, to give you worship. Lord, I pray this morning that you would accept our worship. I pray this morning as we have enjoyed singing, we have enjoyed being together, and this morning, as we look at your word, I pray that you would feed your sheep this morning. I pray this morning that you would minister to us through your word. I pray, God, that you would make this text to become alive in our hearts, and that we would see from your word that the goal is holiness. And as we enter into 2020, let us seek through your spirit and your power, your holiness. For it's in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ we pray, and all God's people said, amen. Amen. There are several things that I want to point out to you from God's word this morning. Number one, I want you to see in verse 1 through the first part of verse 5, that we have a trustworthy source. If I were to ask you this morning, what is the great theme of Scripture? What is the great theme of the Bible? Perhaps you may say several things. Perhaps you may say different things. But I believe with all my heart, mind, and soul that the great theme of Scripture and what we see over and over and over again in God's Word reoccurring is that God is faithful. God is faithful to His Word. When we study His Word, when we read His Word, when we memorize His Word, we can know that God is not going to go against His Word. He is not going to contradict His Word. We know that when somebody comes up with a new revelation and they claim it's from God, we can very quickly dispel that. We can very quickly say, this is the authority. God is not going to contradict this or go against what He has already written. Number two, God is faithful to His promises. Think about the promise that He made to Abraham all those years ago, how He has not wavered on that promise. It gives us assurance. It gives us encouragement that the promise that God has made to us in Jesus Christ regarding our salvation, that He won't go back on that promise either. What God has promised, He will not go against. Now we do have to make sure and we do have to be careful when we claim a promise in the Bible. We have to be careful that we are not misinterpreting that promise, but overall, God does not go back on His promises. God is faithful to what He has promised and to whom He has promised it to. Number three, God is faithful to His children. God loves you. God loves us. He is faithful to provide for our needs. He is faithful to minister to us. He will not turn His back on His children. If there is one thing we can scream from mountaintop to mountaintop, it is God is faithful. We have a divine, trustworthy, faithful source. And that is why it ought to be our ambition, our resolution, our goal, whatever word you want to use, that in 2020 we get deeper and deeper in the book. That we spend more time with Him, that we eat and we drink from this stream, and that we trust within the Word of God like never before. When you think about a GPS, what is its ultimate purpose? It is to guide us. It is to lead us. It is to bring us to the place that we need to be. And when you make a wrong turn, and when you don't follow the GPS, and when you do something that is counterproductive to what the GPS is telling you to do, what does it say to you? Recalculating, recalculating, recalculating. I remember in the olden days, when these GPSs first came out, they weren't on phones, it was that box. And I remember going to the beach and it shows a picture of your car on this road. And we're going along following it, and the car just kind of goes off the road. It's going off the road into some kind of land. I don't know where the car's going to. And then the GPS recalculates it back to where it needs to be. It brings it back. It continually brings it back to the path, to the direction, to where it needs to go. You know, there are times as believers that we get away from God, that we backslide. There are times we go off the path. There are times we move away from the goal. There are times we move away from God's holiness and we seek ourselves and we seek our situations. Maybe we burn out. We get out of worship and we don't come to worship like we should. We don't come to worship like we need to. We stray away from the path. And what God's Word does as that spiritual GPS to holiness is it leads us back. It recalculates us back to where we need to be. Now, the problem with reading verse 5 and verse 6 without reading the verses before is that you don't get the context and you don't get the remarkable truth that God wants to say and is saying in this proverb. I mean, if you look at verse 1, look at the way he addresses, "My son, do not forget my law, but let your heart keep my commands." He says why in verse 2. But then look at verse 3. "Let not mercy and truth forsake you. Bind them around your neck. Write them on the tablet of your heart." Verse 4, "And so find favor and high esteem in the sight of God and man." Verse 5, "Trust in the Lord with all your heart." What is God really getting at? What is this proverb really teaching? Let us seek God. Let us seek His holiness. Let us live in this book. Let us search the scriptures very carefully. Let this be the authority in our lives and nothing else. Let us be obedient to His word. And when it calls us out, let us be faithful to understand what that rebuke is and to follow that rebuke. Let us be like Joshua, who said, "As for me and my house, we will serve the Lord." Let us be like Joshua, as God said, "Take this book of the law. Take my word, and don't turn from it to the right, and don't turn from it to the left." Let us be like the Puritans in church history, and let us surround ourselves with the word of God. They were a people who would sew the scriptures in their clothes. They were a people who would write it above their mirror. They were a people who surrounded themselves and saturated themselves with the Word of God. We can't listen to the Bible for an hour a week and then fill our heads and our hearts with everything but God's Word and expect to walk in a strong walk with Him. We need to saturate ourselves with God's Word. Let us be like the radical reformers, like the Anabaptists, who were willing to die for the truth of Scripture. Now, all this month, we have looked at videos. We have taken up an offering for Lottie Moon. We have focused, in a sense, on foreign missionaries, who the reality is at their door, that when they minister, when they preach the gospel of Jesus Christ, and when they share Christ, that very well could be the last thing they share. Death is knocking at their door. But don't think that one day you're not going to be faced with the same reality, where it's either you obey the word of God and you die for that, or you don't obey the word of God and you live. What's the choice? What choice do we make? What choice are we really going to choose when we are faced with that? Let us live in this book, study this book. Let us be surrounded and saturated with this book, and let us be willing to die Word of God, for the truth of Scripture, and for holiness, obeying God at every turn, even when it doesn't make sense. I want you to look at the second part of verse 5 through verse 7, because I want to show you here in the Word a diabolical vice. And lean not on your own understanding. In all your ways acknowledge Him, and He shall direct your paths. Verse 7, do not be wise in your own eyes. Fear the Lord and depart from evil. Carolyn Payne is a doctor. She claims to be a born-again Christian who loves Jesus Christ. She says that she has a ministry. Her ministry is towards women. She ministers to women and she frees women. Her ministry is to provide abortions for women. And she sees that as her way of ministering to these women, freeing them from the awful responsibility of raising children, having babies, and having to have a family, because what's most important is having a career and being somebody. She says, and I quote, "I love killing babies so women can have the life they want to have." That is what she calls her ministry. I understand this is an extreme example, but this is the very epitome of human folly, leaning on your own understanding and leaning on your own views when they are not led by Scripture. I mean, think about how we got to the place we are today in our nation with the cultural sins that we have. How have we gotten to the things that we are embracing today? Human wisdom. Human folly. The Word of God has not become supreme anymore. It's not stayed supreme with many people. We have our own thoughts. We're not guided by Scripture. We lean on our own understandings, not on the truth of God, not on the truth of God's Word. The Apostle Paul in Romans 1, verse 21 through verse 23, addresses this very thing, talking about those who have been wise in their own eyes, those who have walked away from God's truth, and those who have embraced their own truth. Here the writer of Proverbs, here Solomon says, lean not, trust not on your own wisdom, on your own understanding, because when your wisdom and your understanding is not guided with God, by Scripture, where it will end up on some level is going in this direction. It may not get so extreme, and it may get more extreme, but it will move in a direction away from God, away from His truth, away from His Word. Again, think about our culture. Think about our society. Think about all we are facing today with the cultural sins and ask yourself the question, how did we get there? Well, it's very simple how we got there. We got there from ignoring these verses. Lean not on your own understanding. In all your ways acknowledge Him, and He shall direct your paths. Ignore verse 6. Look at verse 7. Do not be wise in your own eyes. fear the Lord and depart from evil. Solomon gives the corrective path in verse 6. Go back to verse 6. In all your ways, acknowledge him, and he shall direct your paths. As we move into 2020, as a church, let God direct us. As individuals, let's live in this book. Let this be our GPS. Let this lead us. Let this establish the road. Let this establish the path. Let this lead us, and let us be obedient to follow God's word with everything that we are. Let us not lean on our own understanding. Let us not lean on our own wisdom. Let us not follow human wisdom, human folly, but let us follow what God's word has pointed out. And when God's word says it's wrong, let us say it's wrong. When God's word says you're moving in the wrong direction, let us call that direction out. Let us not be misguided by ambition, but let us be guided by God's direction, by what God wants this church to be, and what God wants us to do. Look at verse 8 through verse 10, because this might just be the most misunderstood passage. If you look at verse 8, verse 9, and verse 10, it will be health to your flesh, strength to your bones. Honor the Lord with your possessions and with the first fruits of all your increase. Let's just stop there for a moment. Some have looked at these verses, and some have come to the conclusion of a health and wealth gospel, that God wants you just to be healthy and wealthy. And in a sense, first glance of this text, these verses, I can see why somebody might land on that position. Number one, it's an attractive position. Number two, it seems to suggest that, but you have to understand what's at play here is the tendency of spiritual welfare, not spiritual warfare, and that what God is saying is in terms of the tendency, that when you trust God with your life, when you in your house serve the Lord, when you live your life by the scriptures, the tendency is God's blessing on your life. It does not mean because you tithe, you're going to become a millionaire. It does not mean because you serve the Lord that you're never going to get sick and you're not going to die of some kind of disease or be persecuted and martyred. It doesn't mean that just because you trust in God, everything's going to go great and smooth all the time. But the tendency is God's blessings on your life. I want to give you a case and a point. And I asked if I could share this, and I got permission to share it. But I can remember getting that first text, Larry, about Josh. And I can remember just the news about just eating something. His body is starting to go down. His body is starting to shut down. And I know that had to be very difficult for you too, looking on helpless at the situation. Remember when I went to the hospital one night and Larry was there and he shared with me that Josh was actually saying goodbye to him. Thought it was over. Told him, I love you. Basically, I'm going on. I remember him being rushed to the hospital and going through all that he went through one meal. The best case scenario at that time was he was going to have to be on dialysis for the rest of his young life. I can remember the text going out. I can remember the prayers going out. I can remember the visiting y'all and just the trust that you had in God. And I can remember step by step how there was a victory here. There was a victory there. Man, after all, what were the chances that the very place you would take him to first, I believe, the lady had seen it before. She knew what it was. And she said, get him to where he needs to be. And in every step of that journey, as we all watched along via text message, we saw God's hand, we saw God's work involved in that process every step of the way. Till we got the wonderful news that he went home Christmas Eve. And I trust he's doing good today. Here's the point. That very well could have ended a different way. Very well could have ended in Josh going to heaven. And God would have still been faithful. And he would have still been on the throne. And his grace would have still been real and true had that happened. And that has happened before with people. But the tendency is, the pattern is, that when you live your life trusting in God, his grace and his mercy, God's grace is sufficient. God takes over. God blesses as we are all in God's hands. That's the tendency. That's the welfare. Now look at, as we get ready to shut this down just a minute, look at verse 9 and verse 10. Look at what he says in verse 9. Honor the Lord with your possessions, the first fruits of all your increase, so your barns will be filled with plenty, and your vats will overflow with new wine. It sure seems like he's saying, give and I'll multiply it. Almost in the sense that I'm going to tithe 10%, 15%, 20%, and I'm going to get a 85% increase. It almost looks that way. I can almost see how people would read a text like this and they would come to that conclusion, arrive on that conclusion. But understand again the tendency. And understand that when we follow God, we give to him our life. We give to him our possessions. We give to him our resources. We give to him our finances, trusting him with that. We don't give in order that that's multiplied. We give to him for his glory. And the principle is that God takes care of his children. Because while I've never gotten rich tithing, I've never gone without. While I've never had just a bunch of money laying around, I've never been hungry. And it's amazing. Countless people that I've talked to about the issue of tithing. They live by the philosophy you can't outgive God. I've never had one say, I regret tithing. I regret giving to the Lord. I regret doing that. When I gave and I trusted him, God blessed my finances. God blessed me. God saw to it that I did not go with. The whole tendency here is that God takes care of his children. That's a tendency. Now look at verse 11 and 12, and I promise this is it. My son, do not despise chastening of the Lord, nor detest his correction. For whom the Lord loves, he corrects, just as a father the son in whom he delights. We can act like spoiled children when we are corrected, when God corrects. That shows a lack of maturity, shows an immature believer. Or we can respond to God's correction for what it is, as that GPS recalculating, getting us where we need to be, leading us where we need to go, putting us on the path we need to be on. As we move into 2020, let us be deep about God's Word. Let us be fervent in God's Word. Let us trust God's Word with all of our heart, mind, and soul. Let us live our lives in dependence to God, in worship to Christ. And when God's Word rebukes, corrects, let us not despise that correction. Let us not detest it, but let us grow from that correction. And let us serve Jesus in 2020 like we never have before. Let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, God, I am so grateful for your mercy, for your grace, for your truth. Help us, Lord, to not be caught up in trivial things, but help us to have a deeper passion for your word. A deeper passion to study, a deeper passion to live your word before a culture that has denied your word. Lord, let it be our goal to know you better, to know you more intimately. Let it be our goal that we would lead more people to Christ than we did last year. Let it be our goal as a church that we would look for ways to serve you, look for ways to be that ministering church. Look for ways that we can engage in a deeper relationship with you. For it's in Jesus' name we pray this morning.